Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Karl Winsborough, and I'm the resident chef on board the Queen Mary 2. Welcome aboard, and I hope you're all enjoying your vacation. You'll find me situated in the King's Court area, that's deck 7 in the Chefs Galley. Every night we open around about 7 o'clock in the evening, and we do a live presentation, demonstration of the food you're about to eat. And it's a real good time, so come along and have a go. And you can make a reservation at the King's Court reservation desk at on telephone number 23090. I'll just tell you a little bit about myself. I joined the catering industry when I was 16 years of age. I enlisted in the Royal Navy and done 5 years military service. During my service, I was awarded as a Chef of the Year gold and bronze medals, and also first prize for creative cuisine. I also had the opportunity to cook for His Royal Highness Prince Andrew, the Duke of York, and I really, really enjoyed my time with him. From leaving the services due to an injury, I ventured out into hotels and restaurants, and then in 1999 I found myself hungry for travelling again, and my feet were itching, so I started working on board commercial ships, ranging from oil tankers to cargo ships, fishing trawlers even, and cross-channel ferries, and then I found my home here on board the Queen Mary 2. I've been with the Queen Mary 2 since the beginning. I joined the ship on the 26th of December 2003, and up until this time now, I've had a vacation in between. So come up and see me in the Chef's Galley. I'll be glad to entertain you and to cook for you in the evening. And hopefully, you'll have a wonderful time. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. And hopefully, I'll see you there. Okay. Just demonstrate to you a few items of equipment that we use here in the Chef's Galley. Obviously, the most important tool is the chef. And it's lucky I'm here this evening. Otherwise, you'd all be without any dinner. But the second important tool is the chef's knife, okay? I use a particularly expensive brand of knife called Henkel's. This is made in Solingen in Germany. And this blade is ice treated, so it's extra tough and extra sturdy for a good chop on the old chopping board. Stay away from them sort of imitation late night TV knives that you see out there, because they have a very fine serrated edge. And what tends to happen is, with them, is when you're cutting your salads or your vegetables, they're not actually cutting the vegetable, they're actually ripping through the flesh, which causes slight bruising, a little bit of discoloration, a little bit of unpleasant tasteness, so to speak. It starts to go a little bit sour, the vegetable does. So with a good quality knife, you can pick these up in a good catering supply store. I tend to sharpen my knife with a sharpening steel, okay, which is a bit like a file. I'm sure you ladies out there know what a file is, you know, with the old nails. But this one is obviously cylindrical. And what it is, I drag my blade down the steel at a 45 degree angle on both sides. And what this actually does, it takes a thin shaving of steel off the blade to keep the blade nice and sharp. So every time you're using a sharpening steel, always make sure that you wipe your knife after you've done it, because you'll get these very tiny little grey filings in there, and you don't want them in your food either, because they'll make you quite ill. Obviously, when you're sharpening a knife as well, I always keep my thumb on the top of the steel above the handle, okay? So I keep a good eye on it, because when you're getting particularly quick and comfortable with this, you don't want to end up hacking your thumb off and having that in your toss salad now, do you either? Okay, so we're through with the knife and the steel. I'll just give my blade a bit of a wipe there. And now what I'm going to move to next is this little piece of equipment I'm using here is an induction range. Okay, so what this means by an induction range is you have to have a special pan to put on this range, otherwise you're not going to get any heat there. So I can turn this up now, full blast, on maximum heat, and stick my hand straight on there, and it's not going to burn me, or there's going to be no heat transferred to my hand whatsoever. And then we got these special pans, like I said, which are called induction pans, and they got this thick magnet effort on the bottom here. And what happens is, when you put that onto the stove, it makes a chain reaction which allows the electrical current to go through to the heating element, and all the heat will be transferred into the pan. If I can take that straight off and put my hand on there, the surface of the stove is still going to be cold to touch. All right, so this is an excellent piece of equipment. They are quite expensive, but they're excellent and they're very safe as well, especially if you've got small children running around the house. Okay, so we're going to go into our first dish this evening, which will be the tuna tartare, which you'll all have for your appetizer. And what we're going to do is, I've got some yellowfin tuna here, if you can see on the overhead camera there. As you can see, this is the very fresh sushi-grade tuna, and it has to be sushi-grade tuna, because you get this lovely, vibrant pink color. And the flesh is firm, because with raw tuna, it will become a little bit soft, the flesh. So I cut this up while it was still partially frozen this afternoon in order to get these lovely little dices. And what we're going to do here is I'm just going to pop this into a bowl. And to this, I'm just going to add some very fresh cilantro, okay? I picked this earlier on from the captain's cabin, so believe me, this is very fresh. It's got wonderful plants and foliage up there. So with this particular herb, cilantro or coriander, if you know it this way, you can actually slice this up with the stalks on, because the stalks are quite tender and edible, and there's an extremely huge amount of flavor in there. But for decoration purposes, I'm just gonna trim these ones off a little. And what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna very, very, very finely shred these. With chopping herbs, it's a very difficult, it's not a difficult job, it's an easy job, but it's difficult to ruin the herb with a knife when you're chopping. A lot of people, they tend to bash out like this with the herbs, and then they end up with this big green patch in their chopping board. Well, that's all the flavor, it's in the chopping board and not in your dish, you know what I mean? So be very gentle with herbs, because they are a very delicate ingredient. So I'm just gonna sprinkle some of this now straight into the tuna. And to this, what I'm going to do, I'm going to add some fresh ginger juice, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'll just show you a quick way to peel ginger. If you just want to take a clean spoon, and just using the back and the curved edge of the spoon, you can drag that along the skin, and as you can see in the overhead camera there, that just comes away very, very easily, all right? But for this dish, all I need is the juice from the ginger. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to leave the skin on, and I'm just going to run it through a very thick grater. And I'm just going to shred this off with the skin on as well. That doesn't really matter. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to collect this up. This is a handy hint at home to do this if you ever need ginger in a dish, but you don't actually want the fleshy and the stalky bits of ginger. Just grate it up, roll it into a ball into your hand, and just give it a good squeeze. And you see all that juice just coming off there? That's wonderful. That flavor is really going to be very, very present in this dish. Let's give that a shake. Okay, I'm just going to sit this aside just for a minute, and I'm just going to just let this sit together there for a minute, just so it infuses with all the flavours. And what I'm going to do, I've got some rock shrimp here, 1620. And what I mean by 1620 is you will actually get 16 to 20 pieces per pound, okay? As you can see, these ones have been pretty much peeled, but I'm just going to take that tail piece off there, because we don't want that. And as you can see as well, the vein has been removed from the back there, from the center, so we don't want that horrible little piece in there. And what I'm going to do with this, I'm just going to make a little, what they call, batter francais, or a little French batter, just using a touch of flour and a quick splash of milk. Okay, and I'm just going to quickly beat this in together. You don't want the consistency of this batter to be too thick, okay, because you don't actually want to completely encrust the prawn in a batter. This wants to be just a very light, when it's fried off, a very light crispy batter, and not in any way thick or soft, because you know how batter can go when it's been stood out and it's rested for a little while. It just goes soft on the outside, and it's just more like a doughboy as opposed to a crispy batter. Okay, now my batter's made. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to pat this shrimp off with a paper towel, just to remove any excess moisture on the outside of the shrimp there. So when I coat the shrimp with the batter, the batter's just going to stick nice and even all the way around. I've got a deep fat fryer preheated behind me to about 170 degrees centigrade, which is about 300 Fahrenheit, I do believe, or maybe a little bit higher, I'm not sure. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to go and deep fry this shrimp. Just pop that in there. Right, and while that's cooking, just going to go back to our tuna. And what I'm going to add to our tuna now is just a very tiny touch of sesame oil, okay? And when I mean, I'm going to put some olive oil in here as well, but with the sesame oil, be very, very careful, because it's a very, very pungent and flavoursome oil, okay? So what I tend to do, I tend to split it. If I've got sesame oil as an ingredient in a dish, I tend to split it sort of 25% sesame oil and 75% olive oil, just to mellow it out a little bit, because you don't really want that really pungent flavour in this dish. Okay, so I'm just going to put a quick splash of olive oil in there, and just literally a few drops of the sesame oil. And I'm just going to give a quick twist of the old black pepper in there as well. And I'll just give them a stir, just to get them flavours really fusing together and really married together in that tuna. It's important to do this dish with the tuna very last minute, because if you leave that the marination in there too long, the tuna starts to go milky, it doesn't look so pleasant, and it doesn't taste so pleasant either. So literally, you only want to let this stand for literally a minute or two. Okay, for the garnish of the dish, we're going to use a ribbon of cucumber, and I'll show you how to do one of them now. So I just take the top and the tail off the cucumber, and just remove the packaging. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to take a slice of this cucumber, I'm going to slice it in half all the way down the length, so we end up with two long parts of this cucumber. And whilst I'm doing this, I'll just check on my shrimp, which is almost there. And with this piece of equipment here, which is what is called a Japanese mandolin, okay? And it says on this Japanese mandolin, in English and in Japanese, it says watch your fingers. And when they say that, they actually mean it, because the blade is very sharp on these. I'm just going to take one full length cut of this cucumber, so we end up with this lovely ribbon here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to slice this straight down the center lengthways again, so we end up with this lovely ribbon, just like this. Okay, I'm not going to discard of the other piece because I'm actually going to use that as well. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just take my plate, and I have one of these stainless steel ring molds here. You can pick these up in any good catering supply store. But if you can't get these, and you can't get all the stainless steel ones, you go to your local DIY store and get a piece of drain pipe and get them to cut it down for you, and you'll soon end up with an abundance of molds, okay? But please be warned, don't use them in the oven, because they will melt. All right, okay? Well, my shrimp is just about ready. I'm just going to pull that off to drain. And what I'm going to do with my cucumber ribbon now is I'm just going to place this skin side up, of course, okay, right? And this is English cucumber, so you can eat the skin. It is quite delicate and crispy on the cucumber. I'm just going to place this in a circle, just in the mold, right at the bottom there. And what I'm going to do with the other ribbon of cucumber is I'm just going to cut this down into about 2-inch strips. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to finely cut these into what they call a julienne cut, which is like a matchstick cut, okay? So I'm just going to pull them off like that. And this is also been used in many other dishes as well. You might have seen it referred to as spaghetti cucumber or cucumber spaghetti, whichever. But we're just going to call it julienne for now. So here with our julienne of cucumber, I'm just going to sit that in the bottom, just like a nice little bed on the bottom there. Okay, and what we're going to do now is we're going to start to put in our tuna tartare, okay? What I'm going to do, I'm just going to sort of fill this up to the sort of height of the cucumber, okay? Just like that. Let's just set that aside a second. I'm going to go back to my shrimp and take this out of the fryer. And as you can see there, ladies and gentlemen, we've just got a nice thin coating around the batter, around the shrimp of batter. And what I'm going to do with this, while it's still hot, I've got some, as you see on your menu card there, I've got some OJ glaze. I've had to make this in advance, okay, because this is a reduced sauce which takes a long time to make. And what I've got in here is I've got some shallots, a little bit of white wine, some orange juice, veal stock, and some fresh thyme. And what I've done is I've quickly sauteed off the shallots in just a little bit of olive oil, just thrown in the thyme there just to release the flavors, because you don't want to cook fresh herbs too long because the leaves will go black. And into that I've poured some orange juice, and let that really reduce down to about halfway. I've poured in just a splash of white wine. I know it doesn't say that on your menu card, but I like to put just a little bit of wine in there. And a little bit of veal stock. And I've really brought this down, really reduced it and boiled it away until it's just like a thick syrup, okay? And what we're gonna do is we're just gonna quickly roll our shrimp through this OJ glaze. And I'm just gonna pop that then in the center there. Okay, I'm just going to give a little push down just to make sure we've got plenty of room in there for the rest of our tuna. And then what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take the rest of our tuna. And what I did actually miss as well with this is some dark chili paste, which is called sriracha. But in this dish, just to finish this off, I'm going to use some sambal oleg, which is a chili paste from Southeast Asia, which is very strong and it's very refreshing, okay? But I'm only going to use a little bit of this to finish off the tuna. I'm just going to take literally a tip on the end of a spoon like that and just add that into there. And it's always best to add chilies into like raw fish and things like that at the very last minute before service, because the acidity in the chili will start to cook the fish, and this is definitely not what we want to happen here with this dish. Okay, so that's nicely mixed. So what I'm going to do now is just place the rest of this tuna on top of the shrimp in the mold, like so. And we're just going to sort of give that a little press down there, just so the tuna takes the shape of the mold, so when I pull the mold off, it doesn't collapse and fall everywhere, which would be an absolute disaster tonight if that was to happen. Okay. So, now we come to the finishing of the garnish of the dish. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to tease this mold off very gently, like so. And look at that, it stays there, perfect. And what I've got to dress this place, this plate now, is some wasabi mayonnaise, right? And what I've done here is I've just taken any old regular mayonnaise, you know, my particular favorite's Hellmann's, if anybody's a mayonnaise fan out there, and I've taken some wasabi paste. And if you don't know what wasabi paste is, I'll just explain it to you now. Wasabi is a radish that actually grows in the mountains in Japan, okay? It's a green radish, and it's a very, 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 very fearsome flavored radish as well. It's very hot in flavor. And you can buy it just like this in paste form, okay, which is what I've got here on board the ship, or you can buy it in a ground up powdered form as well. And be very careful when you're using this paste as a dressing for any dish. It is very, very pungent, and it's hotter than chili, okay? So just be very careful. So what I've done, I've just taken a little bit of this, and I've mixed it in with some regular mayonnaise, okay? And what I've done, I've let that down a little bit. And what I mean by letting it down is sort of watering it down, but I've just watered it down with a little bit of milk, okay? Just so it keeps that creamy and rich flavor. And what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna take my spoon, and I'm just gonna drizzle some of this around the outside of the plate, just like that, okay? And this is a beautiful dressing to go with this dish. And on your menu card as well, it says white caviar or white fish caviar. I hope you don't mind, but we didn't have any white fish caviar, so I've got some saruga. Is that okay? Yeah? What a shame, huh? So what I'm going to do, just to finish this dish off now, I'm going to take another spoon, and I'm going to take what they call a quenelle. And a quenelle is just like a tiny little egg shape, okay, of any particular thing like cream or caviar, or anything that you're going to mold into this shape. Is what we call a quenelle. And I'm just going to sit that on top of the tuna tartare like that. And just to finish this dish, I'm just going to take it and put in my thumb over the top of the bottle with the sesame oil. I'm just going to take a very fine drizzle or just a few droplets around the outside of the plate, just like this, just to finish that off. Okay? And there we have it, ladies and gentlemen. This will be your appetizer for this evening, the tuna tartare, okay? And I hope you all enjoy it. Thank you very much. We're going to do your next course this evening, which is the grilled steak with Vidalia mushroom, Vidalia onion, rather, and Roquefort cream and the shiitake mushroom glaze. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make the shiitake glaze because this is the longest job in the preparation of this dish. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to put a pan on. I'm going to put it on a sort of medium to high heat, okay? And now I'm just going to use a little bit of grapeseed oil, okay? And I like to use grapeseed oil when sauteing things off in a pan as opposed to olive oil because it has what we call a higher smoke point or a higher flash point level, okay? So I can get a higher temperature in my pan with the grapeseed oil other than with the olive oil. The olive oil will start to smoke and will burst into flames at much a lower temperature than what the grapeseed oil will. So I'm just going to put a splash of grapeseed oil in the pan. While that's warming up, I'm going to take some shiitake mushrooms, which I've got here. And shiitake mushrooms, they grow in Japan and also in the captain's cabin, all right, because I picked these fresh today. And what I'm going to do, I've removed most of the stalk on this mushroom because the stalk, when you cook it out, it will go rubbery and chewy, and it won't have a very pleasant flavor. It'll taste kind of woody, like you've just taken a chunk of bark off a tree and had a chew, like, you know, so we don't want that in our dish. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to quickly, as you can see, I'm just going to cut these into rather thick slices, just rather quickly there with my knife. And I'm just going to quickly saute these off in our grapeseed oil, which we've got heating in the pan there. And we're going to take these to just until they start to crispen up and go a nice sort of golden brownish kind of texture, okay, and color. But be aware, they are brown in origin anyway, so you know, if they start to go black, you know they're burnt, okay? So what we're going to do, we're just going to pop them in there and just give them a quick toss around in a hot pan. And while they're quickly sauteing away, I'm going to take you through the preparation here of our veal stock. If you can see in the overhead camera there, I've got a nice little bowl of veal stock here. And just for your information, What we do with the veal stock is we take some nice veal bones, we cut them down into rather large chunks, and we take some vegetables, carrots, celery, and onions, okay, and we roughly chop these. And what we do, we roast all of this off together in the oven with any kind of leftover herb stalks or whatever herbs you've got in there, dried herbs. And what we do then, when they're nicely roasted off, golden brown and caramelized in the oven, we pop all them into a big stock pot, fill it up with water, and what we do is we will boil that for about 15 hours, right, just to extract all those flavors from the bones, from the roasted bones, and from the roasted vegetables. Okay, as you can see now, these are just starting to go a nice golden brown color. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to make a quick reduction of red wine, which I'm just going to pop in there. And also a little bit of balsamic vinegar. And what you want to do, you want to put about half the quantity of balsamic vinegar to wine, okay? So if you're using one glass of wine, just use half a glass of the old balsamic vinegar, okay? Because it is quite acidic to taste. So I'm just going to pop just a couple of good slugs of that in there. And as you will see, this will reduce now to a nice thick syrup, okay? And it will add a beautiful darkness and color to the sauce, all right? So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to bring that down. And just to help this along a little bit, I'm just going to pop in a pinch of sugar into this dish as well, okay? Just to bring that down so it's a nice thick sort of syrupy consistency, which is what we want now to carry on with the rest of our sauce. So anyway, after 15 hours of cooking, what we do, we go back to our stock and we strain it off and we pass it through what we call a fine sieve or a chinoise, okay, right, which is the French culinary term for a fine sieve. And you get then this lovely brown liquid which is left over. And what you turn this into a sauce, right, you can either do it the old method and use a roux as the base of the sauce, which is flour and butter which is melted, add the flour, nice and thick, add your stock to that thick amalgamation there and just sort of blend it in until you've got a nice thick sauce. Or what we do now in the modern day is we use a reduction method. And this is what the method we're going to use tonight. We're going to use a reduction method tonight. And what you do is you take the amount of liquid and you just keep it boiling away just like this on the stove until the liquid has evaporated and naturally thickened up, okay? Until you've reduced it by at least half. That's always a minimum, okay? So anyway, as you can see now, little red wine and sort of balsamic reduction. This has gone to a nice syrupy consistency with those shiitake mushrooms there. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to pop in all of our veal stock. I'm just going to sip this now on the back stove here. All I want to do to this now, I just want to reduce it all the way. Reduce it all the way down until you've got this lovely thick glaze with these lovely, beautiful browned off shiitake mushrooms, okay? So I'll just sit that on the back there. And while that's sitting on the back there, I'm just going to quickly sear off our steak. Okay, so as you can see here, I've got a beautiful piece of sirloin steak and I've had it sitting on some paper towels, and the reason why I've done that is I want to absorb all the excess moisture from this steak now, from the outside of the steak, because it's been in the fridge, it's going to be quite moist. So I just want to pat that off and take away all the moisture, because when I'm sticking this into a hot pan, any cold moisture that goes into this hot pan now is going to really take away that heat from the pan, and this is when your meat or fish or whatever you're cooking in the pan, it will start to stick then, okay? And we don't want it to stick tonight because we're doing a TV presentation. So I've made sure this piece is extra dry, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to take a nice clean sauté pan. I'm just going to pop that onto a nice high heat. And again, with my grapeseed oil, I'm just going to bring this to the warm in the pan. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to lightly season my steak now. As you can see, I'm just going to give it a nice twist of black pepper and a nice little light sprinkle of salt. I'm just going to pat that in there just so it retains into the meat there when I cook it. I'm going to do the same on the other side. And if you've got these on the table, these are absolutely fantastic. Salt in the top, pepper on the bottom. You can't be bad, huh? Okay, so I'm just going to pat that down. And my pan is nice and hot. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to place this into the pan. If you watch me carefully, I'm going to place this in away from my body, okay, and away from my face, all right? And the reason why I do this, because you've got hot oil there, and if you slip by accident with the meat there, instead of it falling forward and splashing all over your body, because it is very hot oil, or splashing into your face, put it in the other way so it splashes away from you and not towards the body. That's just a little safety tip there. Okay, so what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to seal off this piece of meat, and we're going to be cooking the steaks medium tonight, so I hope everybody's okay with a medium steak, yeah? Rare, okay, we'll try and cook them a little bit less for you. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to seal this rather quickly, either side, just until it's a nice golden brown. I'll just turn this over now. And as you can see there, the meat is just starting to go a nice golden brown all over the meat there. And that's the natural sugars in the fibres of the meat just coming to the surface there and caramelising around the outside, okay? So I'm just going to take this off the heat now and pass it onto the back stove and just keep that ticking over. And the next thing we're going to move on to is our Roquefort cream, okay? Which is a beautiful component to this dish. So I'm just going to take another lovely clean pan. I'm just going to bring this up on a medium heat. And instead of a Vidalia onion tonight, because we're a little bit short-stocked on board and Todd English needs some more for his restaurant, I'm going to use a red onion, okay? All right? Which is just as sweet in flavour, but I think it adds a lovely contrast of colour as well to this dish, because the sauce is predominantly white, and it would be nice to see just a little bit of extra colour in there, along with the peas and the ham. So I'm just going to quickly top and tail this onion and remove the outer skins, okay? I'm sure your housewives out there have done this many, many times before, so you know how to peel an onion. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to slice this in half. We're only going to use half. And as you can see, you've got the circles or the ringlets of onion going this way. So I'm going to slice this not in the ringlet way against the ringlets. I'm going to cut it in the other way across the ringlets, okay? So I'm just going to cut this really nice and thin. As you can see, my superb knife skills there. It's a good job the weather's not rough, otherwise you'd have fingers in your dish as well. Okay, so I'm just going to take another little bit of my grapeseed oil. And I'm going to take this lovely, very thinly sliced onion, and the way I've sliced it the other way, not the ringlet side, but the other way, is because you come out with these lovely little strands as opposed to half ringlets, okay? And this is what we want for presentation reasons in our dish. I'm just going to pop them into my hot pan. Just give them a swirl around and a little toss there. And what I want to do to these, I want to cook these so they're opaque, okay? So they're not very soft, so they're still slightly crunchy. And what I mean by opaque is if you had just one whole leaf of the onion there and you cooked it opaque, it's still crispy, it's still firm, but it's transparent and you can see through it, okay? And that's what I mean by opaque. We're just going to caramelize these off. And as you can see, they're starting to go a lovely golden brown now, which is almost caramelized. And what I'm going to do is just a very, very small pinch of sugar just to help them along a bit there, okay? Right. Now, they're nicely caramelized now. So what I'm going to do, it doesn't actually state this on your menu card, but I'm going to take just a little splash of white wine. And I'm just going to pop that in there. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to bring this down to a very, very, very fine reduction, okay? Until it's almost just like completely evaporated, all right? So just leave that bubbling over there. I'm just going to turn around and check my steak, make sure everything's still going on all right. Perfect. Just check my shiitake reduction there, and it's coming along lovely. Okay, so what I'm going to do for this dish now is I'm going to add some cream, okay? Oh, I'm just going to pour this in there. It's going to be about maybe about half a pint of cream. I'm just going to reduce that down to around about a quarter. And be careful when you're working with cream. Try not to use any of these half-fat or sweetened creams, because when you're adding these to hot liquids, they will just completely separate straight away, and you'll end up with like a lumpy, you know, scrambly, eggy type dish, okay? And you don't really want that. It's quite unpleasant. Okay, so while our cream, I'll just turn the heat up a little bit there. What I want to do to this, I want to bring it to a rolling boil. Not a fierce boil, but just a rolling boil, because as you know with cream or milk, when you boil it up, it tends to boil all over the pan and then all over the stove, and then before you know, you've got a nightmare on your hands with a scouring pad and some very heavy degreasing detergent, you know? So always keep an eye on it when you're boiling a dairy liquid. And to this now, I'm going to add our ham, which I've cut again with that julienne cut, okay, that very fine matchstick cut. I'm just going to pop that in there while the cream is reducing, because I always like to add my ham early into a sauce, because it really, when you're boiling away, all the saltiness, all that rich flavor comes out of the ham then and incorporates into the sauce, so you get that effect going on as well. And it just seems such a shame just to waste that flavor, you know what I mean, when you're making a sauce. It's like when you make a good tomato soup, and some people are vegetarians, I know there's nothing wrong with being a vegetarian, but you can't beat a traditional tomato soup when you've boiled it away for hours on end with that big ham hock in there, you know. And you just get all that lovely, salty, rich flavor. I do feel sorry for vegetarians, actually. Out such good food, you know. Okay, so this is reducing along lovely now. Into this now, we're going to add our green peas, okay? And these are just any old household garden peas that you can buy in a supermarket frozen, or you can buy them fresh. These ones are fresh. I got these also from the captain's cabin this afternoon. He's got a wonderful jungle up there. You really should have a look. You know, if you get time, get up there and have a look. Okay, so just checking on my shiitake glaze, which is beautiful. Just checking on my steak. And we've got our Roquefort cream on the boil here. I'm just going to remove this from the stove here and just put it on the back. Just out of the way there. And while that's going on, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go through the starch component of this dish, which is going to be a crouton made with Tuscan bread, okay? And what we're going to do with this is I'm just going to quickly, lightly brush this with a little olive oil. I haven't got a brush, so I'm just going to sort of, that's the wrong one. So I'll use all these square bottles so you can't tell the difference, can you? So I'm just going to drizzle a very fine bit of olive oil just over the top and the bottom of the bread. I'm just going to rub that in just ever so slightly. And what I'm going to do with this, I'm going to toast this off in a dry pan, okay? You can do this under the grill, under the salamander grill, if you've got a salamander grill at home, or you can actually toast this in the toaster, it really doesn't matter. But just as long as it's sort of toasted evenly on both sides. So I'm just going to warm up a pan on full heat here. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to pop that in there. And then we're going to go on to our next part of the dish, which is the vegetable component, which is going to be sauteed spinach with garlic, okay? So I've got some lovely baby spinach here, which I've got from the greengrocers today. I nipped out on my bicycle. And as you can see, I've washed this, but I haven't dried it. And the reason why I'm not going to dry this is because we're going to saute this, we're going to flash in a pan, saute this. And that liquid, those very small droplets of liquid after I've washed it, they're just going to hit this pan, and they're going to evaporate instantly, and of course just a steam bath in there, which will really wilt those baby spinach leaves down straight away. So you really need to be very quick with this dish when you're cooking it, all right? And what I'm going to do then also is I'm going to take some lovely garlic, which I've peeled earlier, and I'm going to take some very fine slivers now with this. Be very careful when you're doing this. I'm a trained professional, so hopefully I'm not going to cut my fingers, okay? But when you do it, you know, please take your time. I'm going to do this rather quickly, but you please take your time when you do this, all right? I'm just going to take the round edge off there, and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to chop this really, really, really fast and really, really thin, so you end up with these beautiful slivers, as you can see there. Very, 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 very fine leaves of garlic, all right? And I think for this one will be enough. I'm going to turn my toast over there and sit this also on the back stove. Now, as you can see, I'm just going back to my shiitake glaze. If you can see that now on the overhead camera, this is really reduced down now, and it's gone to a really nice, dark, syrupy consistency. And if I'm to taste this now, this will be just about ready. And as you can see, that coats the spoon lovely. Perfect. Okay, so I'm just going to take that off the heat now, just to let it sit. So I'm going to take another clean pan, and I'm sure you'll love this, the housewives, when the husbands cook this for you at home, because you know what the rules are. They do the cooking and you do the washing up. You know what I mean? So I'm just going to take, for this dish, I'm just going to take a little bit of olive oil for this dish, okay, because we want the actual flavor of the olive oil in the spinach. So I'm going to take a little dribble of olive oil there. I'm just going to balance that out with a touch of the old grape seed, just so we can get that hot temperature in. And this is on full heat. Now, so be careful when you do this at home. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to take my beautiful slivers of garlic, and I'm just going to pop them straight into the pan. And these are going to cook very, very quickly. And you want to take them to a very golden brown color. If they go over the golden brown, it's got to go too dark. The garlic becomes very bitter, and it's not going to taste at all nice in your spinach, okay? So you have to be very quick with this. So what we're going to do, as you can see, they're just turning a nice golden brown. And I'm going to take my lovely baby spinach here. I'm just going to pop that in straight away and just give that a good toss around, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm going to turn the heat off the stove now, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to let this sit now in this hot pan. And the residual heat in this pan now will fully cook that spinach, okay? Well, you don't want to see that. But anyway, as you can see, on the one side of my crouton, this is gone a lovely golden brown colour now, okay? So be very careful when you're doing that, because you can burn them, all right? But as you can see, mine's not burned, all right? Okay? So now we're coming to the plating up now with this dish, okay? So I'll just select my plate here, which is a lovely round plate. And the base of this dish is going to be the spinach. So what I'm going to do before I put the spinach on the plate is I'm just going to take a few paper towels, okay? I'm going to take the spinach out of the pan, because don't forget, there's a lot of moisture still left in this spinach, okay? And before I take it out of the pan, I'm just going to give it a little twist of black pepper there and just a little shake of salt, just to season it up there. I'm going to sit this now on a paper towel, all right? And the reason why I'm doing this is not because I want it to go cold, is because that fresh, lovely baby spinach holds a lot of moisture inside it. So when the leaves have wilted down, all right, and the heat is still inside there, it's still going to carry on cooking. But because the heat is not that fierce to create too much steam, the moisture won't evaporate. So I'm putting it on a paper towel. It's going to draw out all that excess moisture now, because the worst thing in the world is when you're eating spinach, you end up with a swimming pool of spinach on your plate. And I mean, it's no good to eat, and it's certainly no good for swimming in either, all right? So I'm just going to let that dry off a second. And this hat is annoying tonight, I tell you. It wants to fall off everywhere. So I'm going to go back to my Roquefort cream. And as you can see now, this is reduced lovely, okay? The white wine has evaporated. All the alcohol is gone from there, but just the flavor of the grape is left over. The cream is really, really reduced, so it's nice and thick, and it's a lovely palatable sauce. So what I'm going to do now, I've taken this off the heat, right? And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to let it cool down a little bit. So I'm just going to toss it around just to get some sort of room temperature air in there to stop it from bubbling. And I'm just going to put my Roquefort cheese into this sauce now, because I don't want this cheese to dissolve away completely in the sauce. What I want some sort of half-melted lumps of Roquefort in there, you know? And does anybody know anything about Roquefort cheese in the audience there? All right, okay, well, I'll tell you this. Well, only one person said yes, so I'll just run through it quickly, right? How this cheese was discovered, right? This cheese was discovered around about 300 years BC, okay? So that's 300 years before cooking, right? And what happened was there was this gentleman, he was working in the mine, and one day he just completely forgot to eat his lunch, and he went home happy as Larry, left his lunch there, and after, I don't know, maybe a couple of weeks, the mine became disused, and some kind of civil war effort was going on in France at the time, in the south of France, near the town of Roquefort, and he went and took refuge in this old mine where he used to work. And desperate as a man that he was, he came across his lunch, which he left there months earlier, which did consist of sheep's cheese, okay? But only in this particular unused mine, this particular cave in France, does the bacteria grow to create the Roquefort cheese and that lovely rich green and blue vein that goes through the cheese. And it's only here that they can actually cultivate it. Roquefort is protected by law, so if you're looking to buy Roquefort cheese in a shop, always keep your eyes open for a nice little red sheep on the label, and that will assure you that it's a genuine Roquefort cheese, okay? Without that sheep, then it is an imitation, and you must let the manager of the store or the retail owner know about this, because it is actually copyrighted and protected by law. So, wonderful little story, and the guy wasn't even ill when he ate his dinner, so what can I say? So our sauce is cooled down lovely now, so I'm just going to throw in these lumps of Roquefort cheese, okay? And I'm not going to whisk this in or stir it in any kind of way. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to swirl it around the pan just so it sort of coats, the sauce coats the cheese so it can start breaking it down. We don't want to bring this sauce to the boil, and we're going to serve it sort of lukewarm. If you do bring this sauce to the boil, it's all going to separate and split, and it's just going to look like a horrible runny mess on the plate, all right? So anyway, back to our spinach. I'm just going to take our spinach here now and pop this dead center of the plate, okay? And as you can see there, ladies and gentlemen, I wasn't lying about the moisture of the spinach, okay? So we just discard of that. And on top of our spinach, I'm going to place our lovely golden brown crouton, which you saw me toast into a dry pan there. So I'm just going to pop that on top like so. And our Roquefort cream has just been sitting just long enough now, so I'm just going to take a generous scoop of this Roquefort cream, you know, those lovely half-molten sort of lumps of Roquefort in there, the lovely garden peas, and the sweet onion, okay, with this lovely cream and wine sauce. I'm just going to spoon this delicious sauce on top of the crouton like that, and just a little bit of extra sauce there to run over into the spinach, because you're really going to enjoy that rich flavour. Just remove that. And obviously keeping my plate nice and clean. I'm going to return to our steak. And what I've done here with our steak now is pan-fried it both sides, so it should be perfectly medium rare in the middle. I'm just going to sit it down on some paper towels, okay? And what I'm doing, why I'm doing this is, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to rest the meat slightly before serving it, okay? So I'm just going to sit it there just for a couple of minutes, and I'll just explain to you what I mean by resting the steak, okay? When you're cooking meat in a frying pan or on a, like a barbecue or a hot pot or a range or whatever, when you stick it into that instant heat and you're searing the outside, all the muscles, you know, just like Arnold Schwarzenegger, they all tense up inside and they become really, really tough, okay? So you cook the one side and it's nice and caramelized and golden brown, and you do the other side, and that piece of meat is the most tensest piece of meat you've ever felt in your life, okay? It's really had a good session down the gym. So what we do, we take it out of the pan, and while it's all tense, all the juice is coming out of the meat, okay? So what we do, take it out of the pan, sit on a paper towel to absorb any excess moisture coming out of the meat. But what will happen is, when the meat is slightly cooling down and relaxing, this is what we mean by resting the meat, we let it relax. Those fibers, that muscle and the fibers in there, they sort of unwind, you know, chill out for a little while, and they withdraw all that moisture back inside the meat, okay? All right, so this is always important. You know, when you go to a steakhouse and you have this big lump of steak on your plate with a pool of blood around it, that's because the chef hasn't rested his meat properly, all right? Okay, and then the first bite you always have is always the worst because it is very tough, you know? So what we've done now, we've rested our meat, and I'll just show you. I'll just take it off the napkin and place it onto the plate like so. And as you can see, it sort of leaves a dry, oily patch. It's not a wet patch, it's a dry, oily patch, okay? And what that is, all the moisture's come out of the steak, it's relaxed and absorbed all that moisture back in there, so basically you're just left with the stain and that's it, all right? So you're losing no flavor there whatsoever. So now, to finish this dish off, okay, we're gonna go back to our beautiful shiitake glaze, as you can see there. This is really reduced now down to a really fine syrup. There's hardly any liquid in there whatsoever, just the glaze, which is what we want. And I'm going to take, and I mean a generous spoonful of these shiitake mushrooms. I'm just going to sit that on top of our steak. And I'm just going to put some more sauce over there, just to let it run down. And what we're going to have a sort of a two-tone color effect going on here with the cream, the Roquefort cream and the shiitake glaze, okay? Just clean the plate. And just to finish this dish, what I've done, I've taken the ends of a scallion onion, okay, or a spring onion. I've just taken the green ends, okay, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut these in half, just the length, and now I'm going to sort of just split them open with a very sharp knife, okay, and flatten them out. And what I'm going to do is, going back to that julienne cut, that matchstick cut, this is an extra fine sort of matchstick cut, okay? We're just going to give it a very quick slice, like this. I mean, this kind of thing you can do in advance, but I just thought I'd show you. And you can sit them in a little pot of water, leave them in the fridge, and they'll go all nice and curly, all right? They're a very nice garnish. Anyway, so what we've got here is our julienne or spring onion, and we're just going to pop that on top of the dish, just like that to finish it. And there we have it. Ladies and gentlemen, this will be your main course for this evening, which is the sirloin steak with the Roquefort cream and shiitake glaze, okay? And I hope you all enjoy it. It's a particularly favorite dish of mine. Okay, so for all you chocoholics out there, stand by and be ready to be amazed, okay? Okay, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to separate my eggs for this dish, because what we're going to do, we're going to sort of cream together the eggs and the sugar, all right? So I've selected myself, obviously, we're on the Queen Mary 2 now, as you know, the tallest, widest, longest, most grandest, luxurious ocean liner in the world. And because it's the largest ship in the world, we have some of the largest equipment. So I selected one of the smallest bowls I could find here, right? And in here, what I'm going to do, if you're following with your recipe cards here, I'm going to cut this recipe in half just for the demonstration, okay? But this recipe is a good one to follow when you're doing that at home for yourselves for a little dinner party. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to crack two eggs into my very small bowl here. And be careful, I'm a professional, so I've been practicing with two hands for a long time, all right? So if you tend to get a bit of eggshell, sorry, ma'am, yes? You want to ask a question? Well, yeah, what I do, I use 2-to-1. So with this recipe, if you're using two eggs, I'll use one egg yolk extra. But if you're using four eggs, I would give two egg yolks, okay? A quarter pound. That'll be approximately 4 ounces in weight, which would be your two egg yolks, yeah. Okay? Right. So I'll just I'll just set that aside. What I'm going to do, I'm going to separate an egg now, because all I want is the egg yolk, okay? So there are two ways of doing this. You can crack the egg in half, break it open, and sort of wobble it back and forth the shells, as you mostly know at home, and you do this at home. But this is just a quick way. If you can crack an egg with the one hand, just get your hand and open it up and just spread your fingers only very slightly and just crack the egg into your fingers. And if you just roll it around in your hand like that, as you can see, all the whites just drop straight through your fingers, and then all you're left with then is just one clean yolk. So we're just going to pop that in our bowl with the rest of our eggs. And as I was saying, if you do happen to drop a piece of egg shell into your eggs, rather, into your mixing bowl, if you just keep the half of your eggshell and just fish in there and scoop it out, the egg shell will attract that tiny little piece of eggshell back into it. So that's an easier way of doing it, other than just getting your finger in there and swishing around for a good half an hour to find that little piece of shell. I mean, if you've got the time, you can do that anyway, you know what I mean? But if you haven't got the time, that's a real quick method. I've got my eggs into my bowl, and what I'm going to do, I'm just going to pop my sugar into the bowl as well. On the actual recipe card, if you're reading the instructions for this menu here, it will say beat your eggs first until light and fluffy, then add your sugar, right? It doesn't actually matter. You can do it that way and then add your sugar, but it just takes a little bit longer of a time. If you do your sugar and your eggs together, the sugar will dissolve into your eggs, and you will find that your eggs will whip up that just that little bit quicker than if you were doing it without the sugar. So I have my eggs and sugar in a bowl, and what I'm going to do, referring back to the largest ship in the world, is I'm just going to give these a quick whisk, okay, just to get them started. So just going to give these a little bash around in the pan now. I'll just set this large whisk aside because it is a little awkward. We'll just get back to a little bit of normality here, okay? So what we will do now, we'll just quickly beat these together. And as you can see already, there's plenty of air, plenty of volume getting in there. And you want to take these quite to a fast stage until they've like pretty much tripled in volume, okay? And until you've got like a ribboning consistency. I don't know if anybody's ever made a sabayon before. That you get this very light, fluffy, and when you run it back on itself, it'll just sort of sink back in. It's called a ribbon consistency, okay? So I'm just going to set that aside, and just pretending that we've got an electric whisk on the go over there. What we're going to do, we're going to start melting our butter and chocolate now, right? Okay? So I'm just going to take a clean pan from the stove over here. I'm just going to bring this heat up very gently. You don't want to add this too hot, because chocolate will burn very quickly, and also does the butter, okay? So for this one, I'm using just 1/8. I'm going to use the double recipe on here because the little bit of chocolate and butter mixture that I'm going to have left over, I'm going to make a quick sauce with that, okay, to go with this dish. But that isn't actually on your recipe card, so I'll explain that to you as I'm going through it, okay? So I'm just going to take a nice generous lump of butter here, approximately 3/8 of a pound, so it says there. And I'm going to just start melting this off now in our saucepan. Put this on a low because we don't want this to go to what they call a beurre noisette or a nutty butter flavour, because that will add a nuttiness to the chocolate cake that we don't want there, okay? And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take myself a big slab of the old dark chocolate, and like I said, if you're going to use chocolate, it has to be a very dark, bitter chocolate, a good 63 or 64% cocoa solids in there. A particular good chocolate you can use for this is Manjari, and that's spelled M-A-N-J-A-R-I. Okay, that's a very good chocolate to use, okay? And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to, as you can see, I'm starting on the tip of the chocolate here, right? It's always a top tip. If you ever have this big cooking block of chocolate, it's always good, using a very sharp knife, to start on the smallest and sharpest point of the chocolate, okay? Because this will make it easier for cutting, and you can cut it very quickly. So we're just going to go down, and you have to be quite firm with this because chocolate is fairly solid. And we're just going to take off about the same amount of chocolate as what we have margarine butter, okay, which is about 3/8 of a pound. And as you can see, I'm always chipping away at the sharpest point on the chocolate just so it makes it easier to break up, okay? Because otherwise, you know, if you're going to start in the middle, you're going to start flipping your knife around everywhere, and in your chocolate cake, you start having bits of fingernail and bits of finger. And that's not going to be very pleasant when you break this lovely chocolate molten cake open. Okay, so I think this is about enough chocolate now. And what I'm going to do, as you can see, my butter's on a very gentle melt here, okay? And what I'm going to do, as this liquid is now nice and hot, I'm going to put my chocolate into this liquid so they both start to melt in together. This is an easy way of doing this. If not, you can do this in the microwave as well at home, you know what I mean? But keep an eye on it, because chocolate, as I said, it will burn very quickly and it will start to crystallize. And what I mean by crystallizing, it goes to a sort of gritty texture, okay? And that's when the chocolate or the sugar in the chocolate is actually burnt and caramelized and crystallized, and it leaves a very unpleasant sort of gritty feeling in your mouth. So just be very careful when you're melting your chocolate. Ideally, when you're melting chocolate, especially for tempering, if you want to make sort of chocolate shapes and stuff like that, you would just only melt it on a very, very low heat. And I wouldn't bring the temperature above about 27 degrees Celsius, which is about maybe 60 Fahrenheit, perhaps maybe a little more than that. I'm not too good on the equations there. Never mind. As you can see, the chocolate and the butter is now melting nicely together, okay? And it's sort of a nice silky thick sauce going on there. I'm just going to leave that just simmering on the heat to remove my chocolate and give my bench a wipe. So what I'm going to do now is just I'm going to continue to beat the eggs just a little bit further. But obviously I won't be able to take it all the way for the demonstration because you do actually need a hand, an electrical hand appliance for this, okay? But you could do it by hand, but it will take you a long time and you'll end up like Arnold Schwarzenegger after. Really big and beefy. So as you can see, I'm just getting loads and loads of air in here now. And when this goes to that thick sort of ribbon, sabayon ribbon consistency, okay, when it starts to set back on itself, at this stage then, we want to be adding our chocolate and our butter, okay? But I exercise extreme caution doing this, okay, because you're pouring a hot liquid now into basically raw eggs and sugar. So what I would do, I would add this very little at a time, because otherwise if you add it all in at the same time, all you're going to end up with is with chocolate scrambled egg, basically, and you don't want to have that for your dessert, do you? Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm just going to add just a little bit of this at a time. I'm just going to stir this in as well. And you can do this on the electrical whisk as well, like, you know what I mean? So you can beat this cake quite vigorously. It is very arduous and it will take a lot of pounding, all right? And what I'm going to do then is just add just that little bit more in there. And what I'm going to do with this, I did say that I was going to double the recipe on this chocolate and butter liaison, because I'm going to keep this and I'll show you what I'm going to do with this a little bit later on. I'm just going to set that aside. So as you can see it now, we have our eggs, our sugar, our chocolate and our butter all whisked in together. Plenty of air in there, plenty of bubbles, so it's going to give it that extra lift when we bake it off, okay? Okay, now into this mixture now, I'm going to add our flour, which is weighed out, and I do believe a quarter of a pound, but we're going to go to an eighth of a pound just for this recipe, because we're only actually making it, I'm making two portions for the display. Sorry, ma'am? A quarter of a pound is going to be half a cup, okay? I do believe it's 8 ounces to a regular US size cup, so yeah, a quarter of a pound, which will be 4 ounces, will be half a cup, all right? So I'm going to do this flour now. I passed it through a sieve, okay, and give it a nice good sifting to make sure there's plenty of air inside there. Because remember, air is the key ingredient really in this dessert, because we want extra lift when we put it into that hot oven. We want just the air to react inside there and give it extra lift so it's nice and fluffy. So I'm just going to pop all of this flour in, okay? And what I'm going to do with this, I'm just going to fold this in relatively gently, okay, to keep the air inside here. Because if you whisk it too hard, it will sort of fall a little bit, and we don't really want to lose too much of the volume in this cake, all right? So we're just going to whisk this in. As you can see, this is our base, our cake mixture, okay? And we'll have a little raffle later on to see who gets to lick the bowl out at the end of the show, okay? A $10 a raffle ticket as well, why not? Okay, so there we have it. This is our cake mixture. I'm just going to set that aside for a second. And what we're going to do is we have our favorite friendly mold here, our stainless steel ring mold, okay? I'm just going to take a baking sheet. And what I'm going to do, I've just cut myself some greaseproof paper or some grease or baking parchment, whichever you know as, which you can pick up in any good supermarket. And I've just cut a small square piece for the base, all right, which I can sit my ring mold onto. And I've just got a lengthy strip here, which I want to come just say maybe half an inch above the top of the ring mold, okay, just to be on the safe side. The reason why we always give a little bit of extra height as well is just because the cake will rise when it's inside, but if it's rising and it hasn't cooked properly during the rising process, it's just going to spill over the sides and it's going to look like a terrible mess really when it comes to serving, all right? So I just made a small paper tube now out of this parchment. I just put it inside and just sort of swirl it around there with a finger just so you get the nice shape of the ring mold there. And what I would normally do, but I'm not going to do it now, I would grease this as well, just to be on the extra safe side. I would give it just a little spray of pan coating, right? Or if you need to use clarified butter and a pastry brush, just take the butter and just sort of brush in the upward stroke around the side of the mold, okay? And brushing upwards as opposed to around is going to give the cake a sort of a tram line or a train track, so to speak, for it to rise up in the mold. If you brush around, it's going to get stuck. Believe it or not, it will cause very, very tiny grooves, and it will sort of get stuck on the way up, okay? So that's a top tip as well. So we're back to our cake mix. This is ready. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to spoon this in, but I'm going to put it in only to about 3/4 of the height of the mold, all right? So I'm just going to pour this in nice and tidily and neat. But the reason why I only take it up to the 3/4 height of the mold is pure and simple. This dessert is going to rise in the oven, okay? And what we don't want it to erupt like Mount Vesuvius and flow out all over the sides, okay? We want to keep that top nice and domed and nice and clean. Okay, so this is now ready to be put into our oven, okay? On your menu card there, it does actually state that the oven is set at 160 degrees centigrade. Okay, I would change that to 170 to 175, okay? You want quite a hot oven to cook this cake, because this will cook in 11 to 12 minutes. It will be ready to pull out of the oven, okay? So you have to be in Fahrenheit, 170, 345, 350 maybe. But I will double check on that, okay? So don't quote me on it, I will double check. Okay, so I'm going to pop this now into my hot oven, which I have under here preheated. Okay, I'm just going to whack that in there. So somebody bear it in mind that we have a cake in the oven for the next 11 minutes, all right? Okay, so I'm just going to give a quick wipe up here. So while our cake is in the oven cooking away, we're just going to run through what we're going to use to garnish our plate, all right? So we're going to select a lovely, nice round plate, just like this. And what I have here is, I made this earlier on, this is called a raspberry coulis, all right? And this is quite a tart coulis, so there's only 1% sugar in this, okay? So it is quite low fat and healthy for you. And especially if you're diabetic, it's not too overpowering with the sugar there. And what I've done is, I've taken some fresh raspberries, and I've taken a little bit of water, and just that 1% of sugar. So say I used 10 ounces of raspberries, I've only got 1 ounce of sugar in here, okay? All right? And what I've done, I've brought that to the boil, and I've cooked it out for about half an hour, all right? And I passed this then through a very fine sieve, all right? And when I'm passing it through the sieve, I'm also pushing with the back of a spoon through the sieve to push out all that lovely flesh. So all I want left inside that sieve then basically is just the seeds, okay? And we don't want to eat them because they get stuck in your teeth. They can give you an awful bad toothache if you've got a loose filling or something like that, you know what I mean? So we don't want them in there, all right? And what I'm going to do with this, I'm just going to spoon this now onto our plate, okay? Just in the dead center of the plate. And when you're spooning onto a plate into the center, try and get into as a perfect circle as you possibly can. So then all we can do, we can just take the back of the spoon, and we're just going to move that out in a circular motion. Okay, so we end up with hopefully a near perfect circle in the center of the plate. And also this is good because it evens the sauce out. It's not like sort of the Atlantic Ocean with big waves going through the middle of it there. And to this sauce now, I'm just going to finish off. Remember that chocolate and butter that I had left over? Okay? Well, I'm just going to finish this off. And this sauce is going to be called what we call a ganache. Okay? So we take equal quantities in weight of butter and chocolate. All right? We bring them down to the melt so it becomes this nice silky chocolate. Okay? With the butter in there. And while it's still hot, we just take an equal quantity of milk, okay, just ordinary cold milk, or you can use whipping cream, it depends on how rich you want to have this, okay? And we just add that into the chocolate and the butter. And what we're going to do, we're just going to whisk that in together. And as you can see, it sort of looks a bit separated to start off with. It sort of looks like the milk and the chocolate is all separated and curdled. But this will actually blend and fold in together, all right? And a beautiful thing with this sauce is as well, when you cool it down, you can stick it in the refrigerator and it'll turn into a very stiff paste, all right? Okay, and with this paste, you can add some liqueur into that, or you can just keep it plain as it is and roll it around with some desiccated coconut which has been toasted off, or cover it with chocolate vermicelli, and they make excellent petit fours for your Christmas time. or some lovely little treats just for the children when they're running around there. But obviously don't give them the ones with the alcohol in, otherwise you'll have a bit of a nightmare on your hands. And that is it, basically, a nice, quick, simple, rich, and very velvety chocolate ganache. And it's a beautiful sauce to go with this dish. They do actually serve this sauce with the dish up in Todd English, but for some reason it seems to be missing off our menu card. I will get that rectified. So what I'm going to do then is, I'm just going to take a lovely spoonful of this beautiful chocolate velvety ganache, and I'm just going to follow around the outside of our raspberry circle, just spooning away and moving to the outside of the plate, so we end up with this lovely sort of abstract spoon pattern. And what I'm going to do with this now is, once again, from the captain's cabin, I've picked the freshest raspberries that we have on board the ship. So I'm just going to take three of these lovely fresh raspberries here and just sort of nestle them in on the bottom left hand of the circle there on the plate. And also from the captain's beautiful herb collection, I've got a lovely sprig of mint here, which I picked this afternoon. I'm just going to sit that just gently in between those lovely three raspberries and just sort of open it out a little bit, just so it looks really nice and decorative. And with this dish as well, we're going to be serving a fresh homemade ice cream, okay? Vanilla ice cream, which is made on board the ship, and it's a beautiful ice cream. But you can use any good vanilla ice cream that you can pick up in a supermarket, a nice Haagen-Dazs or something along those lines, which is also a lovely accompaniment for this dish. And because we have the sauce on the plate, and we put an ice cream straight onto a sauce, we don't want it to slide all over the place, otherwise it's just going to look like a mess on your plate. So what I've done, so I've just taken a regular ice cream wafer here, all right? And what I'm going to do in a bowl, I'm just going to break these up, just crush it up in your hand, just so you get a nice sort of flaky sort of ice cream wafer dust and flakes there. And we're going to sit this on the plate to sit our ice cream on top of it, just in order to stop it sliding around, okay? So I'm going to just sprinkle a little bit there, just next to the raspberries, okay? And I think it's got to be time now to check our cake in the oven. What do you think, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah? Okay, so I'm just going to reach into my oven and pull out my baking sheet without any gloves. Look at that.
Whoa.
Okay, now this is the tricky part of the dish, okay? So I'm just going to take a flat spatula knife. Now, you can pick these up in a good catering supply store. And what I'm going to do, I'll just show you so you can see on your overhead camera. I'm just going to lift up the corner of that baking parchment and just slide my spatula knife right underneath there and get the whole thing onto my knife so I can lift it out of the tray. And believe me, it's very important that you use an underlying greased parchment paper on this dish, because if you try to just cook it straight on the baking tray, when you try to take it out, the cake will fall from the bottom, okay? And we don't want that to happen, all right? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to tease out this paper ever so gently, as you can see, hoping not to break the cake on the bottom. And what I'm going to do, just as a precautionary measure, but this should actually be greased enough for it to slide straight off, but just as a precautionary measure, I'm going to take a small knife, slide it between the parchment paper and the mold, and just run it around the ring, just to make sure 100% that this is absolutely free from the mold, okay? So I'm just going to slide that off nice and gently there, and then just peel away that lovely parchment paper, which has kept our cake intact. So I'm just going to slide this now very gently onto the plate, because believe me, this is a very gentle and delicate dessert, okay? It could break at any time. All right, so I've had a few disasters myself up in the Todd English restaurant, because I was the pastry chef up there at one stage, so believe me, when you're busy, it's not good fun when you've got a million and one of these to send out to a restaurant. So I'm just going to slide this off very gently and place it onto the sauce. But what I'm going to do, I'm just going to sort of give that a little wobble, just to nestle that into the sauce there, because obviously the sauce and the plate and the bottom of the cake, it will cause a sort of anti-sort of attraction, if you know what I mean, like a magnet when two poles come together and they repel. It will act like that, or like a skating rink, and it will tend to slide. So just give it a gentle nudge onto the plate, and just so it's sort of pretty firm and sat there. And then just to finish off this wonderful dessert now, I'm going to reach into my oven again and get our vanilla ice cream, okay? And this I made earlier on today. And it's a wonderful, delicious, creamy ice cream with Tahitian vanilla seeds inside it. So it's a very rich, vanilla-y flavor. And what I'm going to do, just take a scoop, and I'm just going to pop that just onto our biscuits, like so. And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. This evening, this will be your dessert, the chocolate fallen cake, okay? And thanks for visiting me at the Chef's Galley. I hope to see you all soon. Thank you very much.